Hi everyone, welcome back to Book Bakht. My name is Bakht and I do book reviews. Wait. Bakht and I do book reviews. Today I'm very excited because I'm discussing a book which is really close to my heart, and I read it about 8 years ago and many times since, and it changed my life entirely. It changed my personality actually. So it's We the Living by Ayn Rand. Now most of you might not be familiar with this because most people sort of connect Ayn Rand with The Fountainhead or with Atlas Shrugged. But We the Living is the first book she ever wrote. She was only 25 when she wrote it, and it was out of print for more than 20 years. So if you, even now, if you can get a copy, I think you're really lucky. I got mine from Sidebook Bank. So it's set in Soviet Russia in the 1920s. It's sort of set in the wake of the Bolshevik Revolution. So you sort of see the ruin and the squalor that it created. And it's about this girl, this really beautiful, ambitious, vivacious, kind of dynamic girl called Kyra Alganova, who is the daughter of a man who I think has several factories that manufacture fur or something like that. I don't know, but he's an aristocrat at any rate. And obviously in the wake of the revolution, because you couldn't own private property, they've been brought low. And so it's basically about her sort of quest to survive in these changed circumstances. And then you see other characters come in. It's a triad of protagonists. There's Kyra Alganova, Andrei Taganov, who's a member of the secret police. And there's Leo Kovalensky, who's also an aristocrat. And he meets Kyra, I think, on a train or something. And they fall in love, and so it sort of relates to a state which, as Kyra describes it, has denied life to the living. You know, there's this first scene in which Kyra's sitting on the train and she's traveling back to Petrograd, you know, which is a city in Russia, or was, I'm not sure. So she's traveling back and she's got these silk stockings on, and they're the last silk stockings that she'll probably, you know, ever be able to buy, and there's a hole in them, and she looks down sort of really upset. And you can see how her fall from grace is so sharp, it's so painful, it's almost putrefying her spirit. And you can really feel that happening. You know, she often describes the city as the food being, the food being filthy, the air being unbreathable, the jobs unbearable. And, you know, and Leo Kovalensky, who's the other sort of protagonist, he shares in her feelings because he's used to the same sort of life. But because of his sort of history with... you know, his father fought for the Tsar and everything, so he's unable to keep a job, and so obviously he's, and then he physically cannot take it either, so he sort of contracts tuberculosis and sort of completely gives up his will to live. Leo, in many ways, you know, is the love of her life. You know, she describes him as being a Greek god with having kind of carved features, a very Grecian profile, you know, well-bred and everything. And Andrei Taganov, who she meets in university when she tries to pursue an engineering degree, she meets him there, and he's sort of a member of the secret police. He fought in the Red Army. He's very all communist ideals. You know, he doesn't like any riffraff. He doesn't talk much. You know, he doesn't talk to any woman or anything. And she's completely the opposite because she's a counter-revolutionary, but he's drawn to her because, you know, he sees sort of a spark that he's never really seen in a woman before. And he's of a very industrial quality. You know, his parents died when he was young. He sort of he took to working when he was 11, and he's, you know, he's described as having a very broad kind of structure, very strong hands, very kind of, you know. But obviously for all his demeanor, it's kind of an antithesis because he's very kind and caring. And you know, I often tend to think that this sort of story, this sort of novel, is kind of an opposing play on what most stories are. You know, you see the heroine sort of giving herself over or putting herself in the power of the villain in order to save the hero. But in this, she sells herself to the villain in order to, she sort of sells herself to the hero in order to save the villain. And I'll get back on that. Now, there's this line that he says. He says, maybe I am a traitor, you know, or maybe I finally, or perhaps I finally stopped being one. And you can see that he's going through this kind of, there's a revolution happening inside of him. Everything that he's known is sort of shaking, you know, when he falls in love with Kyra, and obviously it's unrequited, but, you know, she lies to him. And Andre, from many ideas, you know, he's my favorite. From many ideas, he's an ideal hero. He's willing to sacrifice himself for the principles that he holds dear, except that only to realize that those principles are all wrong and they're all a lie. And you sort of see Ayn Rand kind of you know, in opposition, because she came up with a sort of, she invented the school of philosophy called objectivism, in which, you know, your pursuit of happiness and reason and all of these things are supreme, and there's no love or God or principle really, and there's no morality. So you sort of see her through Andre kind of portraying what happens, you know, when you don't care about yourself and you only care about other people. So his destruction is sort of testament to what her philosophy is about. Obviously she was very young when she wrote this, so there's not a lot of her ideals, because I think they weren't fully developed at the time. You know, she'd probably been in America at that time for maybe 5, 6, 8 years. She was sort of, you know, mingling with intellectuals. She was on the precipice of sort of realizing what it was that she believed in. But she's not fully sort of, We the Living is not about that. That's why I like it so much, because as much as I do like The Fountainhead and Atlas Shrugged being unbearably long though, I did like them, but they seemed kind of stuffed to the brim with what she called egotism. Or egoism, whatever. I think she gave it a new spelling for some reason. See, it kind of chokes you. But We the Living is very, it's very raw and painful and beautiful, and it doesn't filter anything out. And it's kind of, it's not afraid to wrench you down into the darkness and make you question everything, you know. And so obviously in We the Living, she sort of remains more autobiographical than philosophical. She sort of said somewhere that this was as close to an autobiography that she would ever write. And I think Leo Kovalensky, the character, is actually someone that she knew back in university in Russia, and Andre is sort of made from scratch. When she wanted to create a hero who had, you know, all the inaccurate and sort of, you know, who had the wrong ideals, but who was, you know, a hero, a sort of a very typical Byronic hero. So Andre, he's described as having sort of two altars in his life. On one he places Kyra, two altars of worship rather, and on one he places Kyra, and on the other he places all his socialist ideals. And then as the story progresses, Kyra betrays him, and that sort of altar crumbles. And then, you know, with the socialist ideas, he realizes that the state is starving the public, and that it's ruining everything, and it's reduced everything to squalor, and that they're poisoning, you know, the spirits of the people, and all the things that he fought for all those years in the Red Army. It's just an elaborate lie, and our power is still concentrated in a few hands. It's just that the hands have changed, which reminds me a lot of Animal Farm by George Orwell, because it's the same sort of, you know, all animals are equal, but some are more equal than others. You know, he sees it and it breaks him. He sees the state sort of transforming into a kind of death dealer, dealing with the lives of the public. You know, there's characters in the book who say things like, oh, you know, so many people are dying, why can't one aristocrat die? Or you know, life is cheap or whatever. You see that the price of life has gone drastically down, and it's only a long time after that Andre realizes it, and he can't take it anymore. He can't deal with the fact that the pursuit of his life and everything that he's ever held dear is a lie. You know, the scene of his suicide, it still haunts me. I still live with it in my head, and every day I find myself back in that room. He's described as you know, staying in an abandoned wing of an old palace where a prince used to stay, and the ceilings are all elaborate and, you know, sort of decorated, and the door is hand carved, and it's beautiful, but it's all empty and kind of ruined after the revolution. And he's staying there, and he's sort of been reduced, you know, Kyra's left him, and he's sort of been reduced to, you know, sort of waiting in ration lines, and he's, because obviously he was enjoying a really good life as an officer of the government, but then he's sort of dismissed and everything. So he sort of comes down to that, and you see that he goes about it very methodically. He slowly climbs down the broken stairs, and he goes into his room, he rearranges everything, he takes every item he has of her, puts it one by one in the fire, watches the flames rise, and he takes out a cigarette and smokes, and you can see that his life is all, his, like, the life behind his eyes is shut down, and he's not even thinking anything. He's found a sort of peace in the realization that it's going to be over soon. And then there's just the sound of the gunshot reverberating through the palace walls, which are all empty and sort of desecrated almost. It's given a sort of, Ayn Rand sort of gives it a kind of a sacred feel. And that's it, and no one finds him for many days. And this, you know, made me think about the first time he ever meets Kyra, and he sort of says, you know, where girls like you belong. And she says, yes, you know, where men like you wouldn't even be allowed in the back door. And he's kind of taken aback because no one's spoken to him that way in, you know, many, many years, and because everyone's afraid of him with the uniform and everything and the power he has. And she's just like considerably younger than him and kind of very sharp and beautiful, and, you know, So definitely, if you can get your hands on We the Living, definitely read it. It will change your life. It changed mine. It changed my personality. I don't know if I've already said that. I think about it every day ever since I read it, and I at least reread it once a year, and it means a lot to me. So if you like these kinds of videos, please consider subscribing. I'm uploading more frequently now, and hit the notification bell. See you later, guys.